Recently, I had a hot pot dinner with several Chinese friends. The new movie Unsilenced, which is now shown in US cinemas, became the topic of the conversation. The movie tells the real story of a PhD student at Tsinghua University who was persecuted for his belief in Falun Gong, a Buddhist meditation in mainland China, and that a brave American journalist tried to get the story out to the world. Two of the friends at the dinner table happened to be Tsinghua University graduates and were disgusted by the party state's persecution of their fellow alumni. What impressed me in particular during the dinner conversation was that several people said these similar things in Chinese. 这些坏人下辈子要遭恶报, or there will be bad karma waiting for those perpetrators in the next life. Wishing someone well in the next life or cursing someone to suffer in the next life is a commonly used Chinese phrase in everyday life. Yet, how many people today, Chinese or Westerners, realize that such daily usage has got to do with the karmic relationships and the idea of reincarnation? I've done a video on karma. Please look up my YouTube channel for it. So, what is reincarnation? Does it actually exist? Let's find out. Welcome to Tea with Erping. Reincarnation is a fascinating topic that I have wanted to talk about. Don't write me off just yet. I'm not here to randomly talk about reincarnation like some superstitious belief. It's actually well supported by scientific research, if I may interest you a little. In the eastern part of the world, reincarnation is almost taken for granted as common knowledge. This is because the beliefs of Buddhism, Taoism, and Hinduism are deeply rooted in the cultures in the East, and they all embrace the idea of reincarnation and the afterlife. In most beliefs involving reincarnation, the soul is seen as immortal, and the only thing that becomes perishable is a flesh body. Upon death, the soul becomes transmigrated into a new infant or animal to live again. Reincarnation, also known as rebirth or transmigration, is the philosophical or religious concept that the non-physical essence of a living being begins a new life in a different physical form or body after biological death. In recent years, this topic of reincarnation has become widely recognized in the Western world. If we go back in history, all cultures, regardless of the East or West, have always believed in the divine and the idea of immortality of the soul. Let me take you back to the time of ancient Greece. In Plato's Phaedo, Socrates, the Greek philosopher, explains to his friends that the true philosopher should look forward to death. Unlike the body, the soul is immortal, so it will survive death. According to the last line of argument that Socrates offers in Phaedo, the soul is immortal because it has life essentially the way fire has heat essentially. The association between Pythagorean philosophy and reincarnation was routinely accepted throughout antiquity. In the Republic, Plato tells Socrates' account of how Er, the son of Arminius, miraculously returned to life on the 12th day after death, and recounted the secrets of the other world. There are myths and theories to the same effect in other dialogues, in the chariot allegory of the Phaedrus, in the Meno, Timaeus, and the Laws. When separate from the body, the soul spends an indeterminate amount of time in foreign land, see the allegory of the cave in the Republic, and then assumes another body. As I've also mentioned briefly in my video on karma, Dr. Brian Weiss, a psychiatrist who graduated from Columbia University and the Yale Medical School, as well as the head of psychiatry at the prestigious Mount Sinai Medical Center in Miami, wrote an influential book, Many Lives, Many Masters, which sold more than 1 million copies in print. This book is known as one of the breakthrough publications in alternative psychotherapy, and remains as provocative and timely as it was when first published, rated as a classic New York Times bestseller. As quoted from his book, scientists are now beginning to seek these answers. We as a society have much to gain from research into mysteries of the mind, the soul, the continuation of life after death, and the influence of our past life experiences on our present behavior. Obviously, the ramifications are limitless, particularly in the fields of medicine, psychiatry, theology, and philosophy. However, scientifically rigorous research in this area is still in its infancy. Strides are being made to uncover this information, but the process is slow and is met with much resistance by certain scientists and lay people alike. Throughout history, humankind has been resistant to change and the acceptance of new ideas. Historical lore is replete with examples. When Galileo discovered the moons of Jupiter, the astronomers of that time refused to accept or even to look at these satellites because the existence of these moons conflicted with their accepted beliefs. So it's now with the psychiatrists and other therapists who refuse to examine and evaluate the considerable evidence being gathered about survival after bodily death and about past life memories. Their eyes stay tightly shut. As Dr. Weiss admits for himself, years of disciplined study had trained my mind to think as a scientist and a physician, molding me along the narrow path of conservatism in my profession. I distrusted anything that could not be proved by traditional scientific methods. I was aware of some of the studies in parapsychology that were being conducted at major universities across the country, but they did not hold my attention. It all seemed too far-fetched to me. Until he met Catherine, one of his patients, who went to him to treat her anxiety problems. He tried his usual methods of psychological treatment, putting her into hypnosis. One day, as she was under one of his hypnosis treatments, she fluently talks in details of his personal life. It was impossible for Catherine to know that his son, Adam, died 23 days after his birth from a rare heart condition. She also knew of his father's Hebrew name, among other personal history that Dr. Weiss never mentioned nor wrote anywhere. This book follows Catherine's different lives. Her gender, her age varies. She's always an ordinary person. She also meets other people in her current life who were reincarnated in other forms, and her nationality constantly changes. This book attributes Catherine's current anxiety to poverty, general hardship, and violent deaths in some of her past lives. She recounts drowning. She recounts life as a soldier whose throat is slit open. Apart from seeing Catherine's many lives, Dr. Weiss is stunned by the transition period in which the soul dies in one lifetime and waits on to move to the next life. During this period, Dr. Weiss hears different voices, what he calls the masters sending him messages of higher truths of the universe. He continues past life therapy on 12 other patients and claims that each case was successful. He does not consider past life therapy a solution to everyone's problems. Instead, he advocates for greater adherence to the credos of the master spirits, which reflects the teachings of major world religions. He hopes that the book will help people not fear death and seek greater harmony with their fellow human beings. For the benefit of their patients, he implores the scientific community to keep an open mind to the influence of past lives. Dr. Weiss' third book, Only Love is Real, takes on the romantic view on reincarnation, how partners are intricately linked to one another in this lifetime after another. We also like to label that connection as soulmates. It usually refers to a romantic or platonic partner, implying an exclusive lifelong bond. It commonly holds that the connotation of being the strongest bond with another person that one can achieve. One will feel complete once they have found their soulmate, as the two souls are meant to unite. The term soulmate first appeared in the English language in a letter by Samuel Taylor Coleridge in 1822. Over decades, the University of Virginia Medical School has done serious scholarly research on the afterlife and the reincarnation, with many academic publications. The school has an entire department called the Division of Perceptual Studies, which studies subjects including near-death experiences, altered state of consciousness, and reincarnation. Its research is even featured in a Netflix documentary series called Surviving Death. Their research is eye-opening. In fact, it could be said that our school textbooks should be rewritten because of their findings. Their work has not been widely known and accepted. And long before the topic of reincarnation becomes a trending discussion here in the States, the influential Swiss psychiatrist Carl Jung has long welcomed with an open arm the idea of lives beyond our current life. As quoted, "My life often seemed to me like a story that has no beginning and no end. I had the feeling that I was a historical fragment, an excerpt for which the preceding and succeeding text was missing. I could well imagine that I might have lived in the former centuries, and there encountered questions I was not yet able to answer, that I had been born again because I had not fulfilled the task given to me." Henry Ford, founder of the Ford Motor Company, "I believe we are reincarnated. You, I, we reincarnate over and over. We live many lives and store up much experience. Some are older souls than others, and so they know more. It seems to be an intuitive gift. It is really hard-won experience. What strikes me most is that the idea of reincarnation is fondly believed by people from different walks of life, from scientists, business people, to philosophers. As you can see in the mind of American writer Ralph Waldo Emerson, it is the secret of the world that all things subsist, and do not die, but only retire a little from sight, and afterwards return again. Whatever does not concern us is concealed from us." As the ancient Persian poet Hafiz said, "Your heart and my heart are very, very old friends." After this episode on reincarnation, it's quite imaginable that you and I are old friends from another lifetime indeed. And together, with a good cup of tea, we shall be likely friends for an even longer time. Until our next episode, peace and tea be with you.